Shall we rise up as we pray together? Heavenly Father, we do thank you for our Bible study. Thank you for the love and the interest you give us every time to come to study. We pray, Lord, that this interest will continue to grow in everyone in Jesus' name. We thank you, Lord, for the way you open the pages of the scriptures and reveal your mind, your heart, your purpose, and the reason for our living unto us. And we pray, Lord, that our study week after week, it will not be in vain, will produce your kingdom in Jesus' name. We pray, Lord, that once again, your spirit will teach us and enlighten us, instruct us in the way of the Lord today in Jesus' name. And we'll not be hearers only, we'll not be students of the word only, we'll be doers of the word. And the grace and the strength and the passion, the divine energy to do what you've called us to do, will do to the glory of your name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. In our study, we're coming to Acts of the Apostles, chapter 14. As you have studied already, we are looking at the second missionary journey or the first missionary journey of Paul and Barnabas out of the church in Antioch. They had gone out, as you remember, Acts of the Apostles, chapter 13, to back up a little bit from verse 1. Now there were in the church that was at Antioch certain prophets and teachers. Then you have the first one, Barnabas, and the last one, Saul. In verse 2, as they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said, "Separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called them." I've read that to you for you to understand, and notice that in verse 1, it says there were certain prophets and teachers. And he referred to these five people, and then among them, Barnabas and Saul. But remember their titles at that time. Let's come to Acts chapter 14 now. I'm reading from verse 14. Acts chapter 14, verse 14. It says, "Which went the apostles Barnabas and Paul." You see a change right there. There were prophets and teachers when they were in the church in Antioch. As the Lord called them and they responded to that call, and they went out with commitment and consecration and courage, and they went to the field where the Lord had sent them. All of a sudden, they're no more referred to as prophets and teachers, but now they are apostles. Which means that when we hear the word of God, respond to that word of God, obey that word of God, that God promotes us. I pray that he'll promote you in Jesus' name. And not just a promotion in title, the anointing that comes with that, the power that comes with that, the authority that comes with that, the effectiveness that comes with that. That's why it's very important for you as you listen to the word of God, and it says this is what you do, that you know there's just one thing to do, just obey, and the blessings of God will spread to many other people through you, and you yourself will be a recipient, a partaker of that blessing in Jesus' name. These apostles, Barnabas and Paul, were so committed to the first missionary journey that they traveled from sea to sea, and from city to city, and they traversed thousands of miles within a period of 12 months. Within that period, they preached everywhere, and multitudes of men and women, multitudes of young and old, multitudes of Jews and Gentiles became born again. They were saved. These were not people that just raised up their hand in a mass crusade outreach. They were the people that turned to the Lord. They repented of their sins. These were people that were actually converted, and these were people that had real transformation in their lives, transformation in their direction in life. Notice that when you go to do evangelism, whether it's personal evangelism or it's public evangelism, or those of us who are pastors, pulpit evangelism, and we invite people to get to know the Lord. We'll say, if you want to know the Lord, you've not been born again, you want to give your life to the Lord, raise up your hand. It's wonderful for them to raise up their hands. But that is not the end of the matter. They must be people that actually repent, will preach repentance, and then will preach faith in Christ. And with the repentance and faith in Christ, there's conversion. And conversion means a turning around. Their lives are not different. The directions of their lives are different. And the attitude to life is not very different. Now they worship God in spirit and in truth. There is transformation. Those are the people who say are really saved. Not only that they are saved, they are steadfast in the Lord. Not only that, they are people that are set apart and separated from their past so that they can face the future of real discipleship. Now, as Paul and Barnabas and their team, as they preach the word of God, we're told that signs and wonders followed. Let's look at Acts chapter 14 from verse 1. And it came to pass in Iconium that they went both together into the synagogue of the Jews, and so spake that a great multitude, both of the Jews or also of the Greeks, that means Gentiles, they believed. But the unbelieving Jews stirred up the Gentiles and made their hearts, their minds, even affected against the brethren. That means against Paul, against Barnabas, against the whole team. Long time, therefore, about this, speaking boldly in the Lord, which gave testimony unto the word of his grace, and granted signs and wonders to be done by their hands. Then it goes on to talk about the persecutions and the challenges they received while they were there. The important thing for us to note is that these apostles or these ministers and missionaries, they were committed to the work of the Lord. They were committed to the assignment the Lord had given to them. And they were not people that were just worshiping the Lord superficially. And were not just paying lip service or eye service unto the Lord. They were people that gave themselves completely unto the Lord, soul, spirit, and body. They went for preaching everywhere, the Lord working with them. You can see the confirmation right there, signs and wonders, healings and deliverances and miracles following after them because they were obedient to the word of the Lord. I pray that as you obey the Lord and you take the gospel in any way, in any form, in any method, that the Lord will use you and bring this gospel to other people, the Lord will work with you as well. It does not work with the people that, you know, just sit down, the people that fold their hands, the people that do nothing, the people that hear the word and they know that this is what you do and they never do it. It goes with the people that actually obey him. Look at Mark chapter 16. I'm reading from verse 15. Mark chapter 16, verse 15. And he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. You see that? It's not just that they hear the word of God. They hear the word, they repent, they believe on the Lord, and they are baptized to identify with the Lord Jesus Christ, his burial and resurrection. And they give public testimony to the very fact that they belong to the Lord Jesus Christ now. They are not ashamed of Christ. They are not ashamed of Calvary. They are not ashamed of the cross of the Lord. They are not ashamed of the very fact that they have come to put their trust, their confidence, their faith, and they have come to rest in the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why we are baptized. And it says, but he that believeth not shall be damned. And this sign shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. And they shall take off serpents. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay their hands on the sick, and they shall recover. So then, after the Lord had spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven and sat on the right hand of God. Look at verse 20. And they went forth. The believers went forth. The apostles went forth. The members of the church, they went forth. Actually, when it says they went forth, it's referring to the whole church. You see, the leaders used mass evangelism as a method, but the members used personal evangelism as their own method. Whether it's the apostles or it's the pastors or the prophets or the teachers or the leaders in the church who went forth for mass evangelism, or members that went to individuals, they all went forth and they preached everywhere, the Lord working with them and confirming the word with signs following. Those are the two basic methods in the New Testament. The apostles were gifted and guided by the Holy Ghost, and they strategically moved from large cities to big towns to villages, and everywhere they found conglomerations of people, congregations of large people, and they preached the gospel, they preached the word, they invited people to repent, and many people gave their lives to the Lord. they planted churches as well, and the members of those churches now, they preach with personal evangelism to the community, to the surrounding communities, and launch them. And this book of Acts that we're reading, that we're studying, is a model for the church, a model for the leaders, that the leaders of the church will not just sit down in one place. Are you a district pastor, a group pastor? Are you a region overseer, a state overseer, or maybe you're the local government? We don't just stay in one location. We move from place to place, following the example that we've seen from this team of apostles and leaders in the church, and we evangelize. And those of us who are individual members, we also carry the gospel everywhere. Look at the example of this for the membership. It tells us in Acts of the Apostles chapter 8, Acts chapter 8, we're reading from verse 4. It says, therefore, they that were scattered abroad, referring to the members of the church, now individual members of the church, men and women, men have their parts to play, women have their parts to play, even young people have their parts to play. Therefore, they that were scattered abroad went everywhere. What were they doing? Preaching the word, preaching the word. And that's what we ought to do. We receive the word, we believe the word, we're living by the word, and then we're preaching the word as well. And as we preach the word, whether we're apostles or pastors or evangelists, or we're leaders in the church and we're reaching multitudes, or we're individual members of the church, many people will turn to the Lord through our preaching in Jesus' name. The three points we're going to consider as we look at chapter 14 today. Number one, commitment to the soul-saving ministry despite persecution. Very important. Commitment to the soul-saving ministry despite persecution. When you look at chapter 14 of the Acts of the Apostles, you'll see that the apostles were committed to the preaching of the gospel, and they were committed to getting souls saved. Persecution was there, the pain was there, and in fact, it was intense persecution, terrible persecution. But in the midst of it all, they still continue preaching the gospel. And what we say for them is what we should say for ourselves, that even though you might have challenges or problems or a kind of pain there, a little suffering there, that should not stop you from sharing the word and preaching the word and telling people around you that Jesus is the Savior. Point number one, then, commitment to the soul-saving ministry despite persecution. Point number two, confrontation of superstitious men. Superstitious men, pagan people, idol-worshipping people that misunderstand the great things they see, and they attribute the power of God to men. The confrontation of superstitious men by dedicated preachers. These apostles will not allow persecution, idolatrous attitude or comportment to go by like that without challenging that. And in our communities too, when you see something like that, that this is superstition, this is idolatrous, you'll not just pass by, neither are you going to be party to that, supporting that. You'll confront it when you can, how you can, and the Lord will use you to destroy all these works of darkness in Jesus' name. Point number three, confirmation of saved and steadfast members in the divine purpose, that those who are saved, they were steadfast in the Lord. And the apostles made sure that they established churches for them so that they can be established in the faith. Very well, we'll come to number one, commitment to the soul-saving ministry despite persecution. Let's come back to Acts of the Apostles chapter 14, verse 1. And it came to pass in Iconium that they went both together into the synagogue of the Jews, and so spake, listen to that, and so spake, you know, it could have said, they spoke, and a great multitude, both of the Jews and also of the Greeks, believed. But that little word there, so, it means that with all their ability, with all their skill, and with all their passion, with all the zeal that they had, they so spake, and they left no stone unturned. They spoke about repentance from right, left, and center. They spoke about repentance, touching their souls and touching their mind and touching their spirit. They spoke about repentance. They emphasized it. That's what so spake means, that they spoke with emphasis. They spoke with conviction. They spoke with some thoroughness. They were thorough about what they were saying. They did not allow the sinners and the backsliders to just hear the word. That was good. That was nice. They so speak that they were led to repentance. They so speak that sinners could not remain in their sin. The conviction came on them, and the conviction drove them to turn to the Lord and to pray unto the Lord so that they could believe on the Lord and be saved. That's why it says a great multitude, both of the Jews and also of the Greeks, believed. Their whole heart was in the message. Their whole mind was in the message. And everything they had was in the message. They were not just speaking and then thinking of another thing, speaking and then fearing something else, speaking and then looking in another direction. They so speak that a great multitude believed. Look at verse 2. But the unbelieving Jews stirred up the Gentiles and made their minds evil affected against the brethren. The unbelieving Jews raised persecution. It's always like that, because of jealousy, because of envy. These other people that believed they had peace with God, didn't have peace with God. The people that believed they had the joy of salvation, and these ones did not have the joy of salvation. The people that believed, they not believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, that we believe he died for us, he rose again, and we believe we have eternal life. We are on our way to heaven. Their testimonies infuriated, irritated these unbelieving Jews, and because of that, they began to slander the apostles, they began to speak bad things about the apostles, and they made the minds of the people even affected. Anytime you slander a fellow believer, it's because you are jealous about something. You are envious about something. There is something other people have that you do not have. There's something other people are enjoying that you are not enjoying. That's why you turn the way of the sinner, the way of the backslider, and then you make the minds of other people even affected towards the brethren. But that did not drive the apostles out of town. That did not shut up the mouths of the apostles. You see, some people, they cannot bear a little fire, a little persecution, a little pain, a little reproach, a little suffering, a little kind of pressure. They cannot bear anything like that at all. Once there is a slander, there is opposition, there is resistance, once somebody is saying, I don't accept that, I don't believe that, I'm not going to give in to that, they become like jellyfish without any backbone. There's no courage, there's no commitment, and then they'll shy away. They'll be so ashamed, or maybe they'll be so afraid, then they'll run away. Not Paul, not Barnabas, not this particular team reaching out and knowing that the souls of the people are very important. Look at this in verse 3. Long time therefore. The word therefore means because of the persecution. We were zealous before, and now that persecution has come, we're going to double our zeal. We were committed before. Because of the persecution, the more pain we have, the more persecution we have, the more perseverance we're going to have, and the more zeal we're going to have. The more opposition we have, the more we're going to get committed to this work. That's what it means there. Long time therefore, about the speaking boldly in the Lord, which gave testimony unto the word of his grace, and granted signs and wonders to be done by their hands. The Lord supported them, because they were not cowards, they were not fearful, they were not people that will say, because of problem, then we cannot do the work of God anymore. Whatever we suffer today cannot be compared with what sinners and backsliders are going to suffer in hell forever. And the suffering of backsliders and sinners will not just be for 10 years, for 100 years, 1,000 years, 1,000,000 years. It will be forever and ever. And if you backslide because of persecution, you backslide because of pressure, you backslide because of pain, you backslide because of your position, then you leave the Lord and you leave the work of God. You leave what the Lord has given you to do. Remember that you can jeopardize your soul and your own eternal destiny. That's why these apostles said, this suffering is nothing, this persecution is nothing, and this opposition is nothing compared with what the sinners are going to suffer in eternity. And they knew that if they were persecuted for righteousness' sake, their reward will be there in heaven waiting for them. That's why it says, long time therefore abode they, speaking boldly in the Lord, which gave testimony unto the word of his grace, and granted that signs and wonders should be done by by their hands. Look at verse 4. And but the multitude of the city was divided, and part held with the Jews and part with the apostles. It goes on to say, and when there was an assault made, both of the Gentiles and also of the Jews with their rulers, to use them despitefully and to stone them. We're told now that it's now a combination of, you know, some of the Jews and some of the Gentiles, and they were going to get together to persecute these people. Look at the result of that in verse 6. And they were aware of it, and they fled unto Lystra and Derbe, the cities of Laconia, and unto the region that lies round about. Look at that word. It says they were aware of it. They were aware of the persecution. They were aware of the thing that was brewing, that some people in their conspiracy, their sick, will stone them, will kill them, will destroy them. And then it says, when they were aware of that, they fled unto Lystra. That word, fled. Maybe that surprises you. Say, but you said the people are courageous. Yes, they're courageous. You say, but the people are, you know, kind of zealous. They are committed to the work of God. Yes, that's what we're reading about them. Why then did they flee? Why did they run away? Well, that's the combination of wisdom and watchfulness. That's the combination of courage and caution. There are some people, they say they are courageous, but there's no caution. There's some people, they say, God has raised me up as a watchman, and because of that, I'm going to watch over those souls, I'm going to do this and that. But there's no wisdom that is connected with that. But you see, there must be courage on the one hand and caution on the other hand. There must be watchfulness for a watchman. There must be wisdom on the other hand. In fact, that's what Jesus said. Look at this in Matthew chapter 10. Matthew chapter 10, I'm reading from verse 23. It says in Matthew 10, verse 23, but when they persecute you in this city, what's the next word there? Flee ye into another. The Lord Jesus Christ said, you have a lot to do. You have to preach the gospel to every creature. You have to preach the gospel to every city. And so, if you are persecuted in this city, and they want to stone you in this city, don't cut short your ministry. There's still other souls that are waiting for you. There's still other people in the whole land. You have to reach the whole nation. And so don't say, I'm courageous, I'm courageous. If you're going to stone me, come on, stone me. I'm ready to die. No, you are not ready to die until you have finished the work the Lord has given you. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. That's what Jesus told them. But when they persecute you in this city, flee ye into another. For verily I say unto you, ye shall not have gone over the cities of Israel. That is, you have a project, you have an assignment, you have a commitment, and this is the commission I've given you. You will go all over the cities of Israel, of the nation, and you will not have gone over like that until the Son of Man be come. It says, I'll be coming for you. But don't waste your life. Don't spill your blood in one city. If they persecute you here, they say they don't want the word there. They don't want the gospel there. Other people are waiting. Go and reach them. So that's the reason why over here you find this. We're coming back to Acts of the Apostles chapter 14. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 14, we see that persecution arose, but it says in verse 7, and there they preached the gospel. And there they preached the gospel. The preaching of the gospel went on. And I pray that in our own lifetime and in your own community where you are, in a great commission the Lord has given to your hand, the preaching of the gospel will go on in Jesus' name. Acts chapter 19, I'm reading from verse 8. Acts chapter 19, we're looking at verse 8, so that you will see the attitude of those apostles. You are knocking on doors, and a particular door that you knock at, they send a dog after you, and they say, don't come here again, don't come here again. There are many other houses. Go to the other houses, and don't say, since they told me not to come to that place, and they send a dog after me, I'm going to go to that same place. Go to other places, or you reach a particular community. While you're in that community, you, they raise up persecution, raise up lies and slander and everything. You go back there again and they persecute you and they want to destroy your life and destroy your ministry. You will go to other places. That's the wisdom we're learning from these apostles here in chapter 19, verse 8. It says, and they went into the synagogue and spoke boldly for the space of 3 months, disputing and persuading the things concerning the kingdom of God. But when divers were hardened and believed not, see this situation now, divers were hardened and believed not. He was there for 3 months, preaching to them and preaching to them. And they said, we hear repentance, we'll not repent. We hear about salvation, we'll not get saved. We're here, be ye holy, we're not going to be holy. We have made up our minds that we're going to be hardened. What will he do? Will he just say, whether you hear or not, whether you accept or not, I'm going to die there, I'm going to keep on telling you, and you are becoming more hardened and hardened. And that's the place of wisdom. We need to be wise as we're presenting the gospel so that your life will not be wasted. I said your life will not be wasted. Your ability, your skill, your talent will not be wasted in Jesus' name. You see, the people who are not wise, they say, it doesn't matter, I'm planting there, I'm sowing there, and they think it's not yielding fruit. It's not yielding the fruit of repentance, the fruit of salvation, or the fruit of godliness. All the same, I'm going to keep on sowing there. And there are all the fields, all the places where you should go and sow. That's why we're learning from the wisdom of the apostles. It tells us in verse 9, but when divers were hardened and believed not, but spake evil of that way before the multitude, he departed from them. You see that? That's fleeing from them, going away from them. He departed from them, and he separated the disciples, disputing daily in the school of one Tyrannus. In verse 10, and this continued by the space of 2 years, so that all they that dwelt in Asia heard the word of the Lord. All they that dwelt in Asia heard the word of the Lord. What if he just stayed there where they were rejecting the word, where they were resisting the word, where they were opposing the word, where they were tearing the word apart, where they were living contrary to the word? But he was wise. I pray you'll be wise. I said you'll be wise, that now the whole of Asia Minor, they heard the word of the Lord, both Jews and Greeks. Look at verse 11. And God wrought special miracles by the hand of Paul, so that from his body were brought unto the sick handkerchiefs or aprons, and the diseases departed from them, and the evil spirits went out of them. And that's the wisdom that we find in those apostles, what they did at that time. Let's come back now as we look at their commitment to the soul-saving ministry in spite of the persecution. We're coming to Acts chapter 14. I'm looking at verse 8 now. And there sat a certain man at Lystra, impotent in his feet, being a cripple from his mother's womb, who never had walked. The same had Paul speaking, who steadfastly beholding him and perceiving that he had faith to be healed, said with a loud voice, stand upright on thy feet. And he leaped and walked. You see how the wisdom became productive, the wisdom of Paul and the wisdom of Barnabas, that as he went to the place where they will accept the word of God, he now said to this man, rise up on your feet. And this fellow had been hearing the word of God, and he was crippled, he was born just like that. He had never walked in his life, and then he just said, stand up, and by faith he stood up and walked. A miracle happened, a great miracle happened. In this way you can compare Paul and Peter and Paul, because you know that in the case of Peter, there was this man that was at the gate, beautiful of the temple, and the same thing happened. Silver and gold have I none, in the name of Jesus Christ, rise up and walk. And he rose up and he walked. The same God that walked with Peter, that same God walked with Paul the apostle. And the same God that walked with them will walk with every one of us in Jesus' name. I want you to see something here of what happened over here. That one, he heard the word of God. And the Bible says that Paul saw something in verse 9, that he had faith to be healed. He had faith to be healed. How did he have that faith to be healed? Faith coming by hearing. And we're looking at Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 10. Hear the word of God. You want to develop your faith? The faith to be healed. Hear the word of God. The faith to be saved. Hear the word of God. The faith to be delivered. Hear the word of God. The faith to be sanctified. Hear the word of God. Maybe you've been there. You are saved. You are sanctified. Not filled. Not baptized with the Holy Ghost yet. With the power. Endowment or power upon your life. Hear the word of God. The faith to receive the baptism, it will come by hearing the word. Acts of the Romans chapter 10, verse 17. So then, faith cometh by hearing. Faith cometh by hearing. Hearing by the word of God. The man was hearing the word of God. He accepted that word of God, believed that word of God, and he just began to feel, I can be healed. I can get up out of this paralysis. A change can come in my life. And by the grace of God, that change came when Paul the apostle said, stand upright on thy feet. And he lived and walked. And can I just tell you that number one, there was confident assurance. Confident assurance. The man, while hearing the word of God, said, I believe this can happen. I believe a change can come in my situation. Number one, confident assurance. Number two, commanding authority. Commanding authority. Paul the apostle, he knew that this man had the faith. He knew he had the confident assurance. Because of that, he commanded it with authority. The authority that breaks the yoke. Every yoke in your life will be broken. And then it says, with that commanding authority, stand upright on thy feet. Number three, corresponding action. Corresponding action. The man did not just sit down there and say, that's the way I was born. I've never walked in my life. I've never taken a step in my life. And now you are commanding me with authority, stand upright on thy feet. But he accepted that. Because you see, you join all those things together. Confident assurance, commanding authority, and then corresponding action, something will happen. I said something will happen. You know, that's what happens in every situation. For example, number one, you have faith to be saved. Faith to be saved. And you have heard the word of God. If I repent, I believe God will forgive me. If I repent, I believe that things will change in my life. If I repent, I believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, I'll become a new creature in Christ. It always starts with that faith to be saved. And then number two, go and sin no more. You'll hear that commanding authority coming from the Lord that now something is happening to you. Your life is being turned around. A change is taking place in your life. Go and sin no more. And then number three, you go and live righteously. Corresponding action. Faith to be saved, and then go and sin no more. And then there is living righteously. If you're under any oppression, for example, any affliction, there is faith to be delivered. You know that the word of God has said that those who believe in him will cast out devils. And when that evil spirit is cast out of you, you have faith to be delivered. And then you just say, woman, thou art set free. You are loose. Go free. That commanding authority will speak to you. And then you respond to that. You'll be in your right mind. Deliverance will be yours in Jesus' name. The same thing was with sanctification. That you have faith to be sanctified. And then you have the commanding authority talking to be pure and be holy. Be ye holy as I am holy. You join that with what you have had, the faith to be sanctified. And then the commandment of God comes, rise up and be holy. And then you are holy, you are godly, and you are pure. It will happen to us in Jesus' name. Let's come now to point number two. In point number two, we're looking at confrontation of superstitious men by these dedicated preachers. Acts of the Apostles chapter 14. I'm reading from verse 11. It says, when the people saw what Paul had done, they lifted up their voices, saying in the speech of Lycaonia, and the gods are come down to us in the likeness of men. And then he goes on to say in verse 12, and when they call Barnabas Jupiter and Paul Mercurius, because he was the chief speaker, then the priest of Jupiter, which was before their city, brought oxen and garlands unto the gates and would have done sacrifice with the people. Which when the apostles Barnabas and Paul heard of, they rent their clothes and ran in among the people, crying out and saying, sirs, why do ye these things? we also are men of like passions with you, and preach unto you that ye should turn from these vanities unto the living God, and which made heaven and earth and the sea and all things that are therein, who in time past suffered, allowed, permitted all nations to walk in their own ways. Nevertheless, he left not himself without witness, in that he did good, and gave us rain from heaven and fruitful seasons, filling our hearts with food and gladness. With these things, cause restrained the people, that they had not done sacrifice unto them. That's why we refer to these people as superstitious men. When they saw the miracle that happened, instead of, they have not heard the word of God. Paul the apostle had preached the word very clearly. He had told them, he lifted up Jesus Christ, that is the name of Jesus, is the death of Jesus, is the blood of Jesus, is the power of Jesus, that is able to do all this today. That if you are sick, that name of Jesus will heal you. That if you are a sinner, that the blood of Jesus will wash you whiter than snow. That's why the person believed, and that's why he rose up and he walked. But these other people, even though they were there, they were not paying attention to the word of God, and so they didn't hear that it was Jesus, they didn't hear it was the name of Jesus, they didn't understand it was the power, the might in that name that healed the man. Because of that, now they wanted to do sacrifice unto Paul and Barnabas, and they called them idols, they called them gods, and they called Barnabas Jupiter, they called Paul Mercurius, because he was the chief speaker, and they were looking for oxen, for animals and gallants that they will use in sacrificing unto the apostles. Well, there are superstitious people like that. Number one, they worship ministers. They worship ministers. The people that proclaim the word of God, that's who they worship. Some people, if they found out their church, they worship. So they will put their picture there. If they want to pray, they'll be looking at that picture, and they'll be bending down before that picture. That's idolatry. Other people, they worship some kind of great man that they have heard of in the past. They try to get their image or whatever, or whenever they are praying, they will use the names of those people who are mere men, ministers, and that is idol worship. That's why Paul the apostle wrote to them and said, why are you doing this kind of vanity? Why are you doing this idolatrous sin? And he stopped them from sacrificing. Other people, they worship the means of healing. What I mean by that, if you look at the word of God, for example, there were times that there was some means, like Naaman was told to go into River Jordan. When he got to River Jordan, all his leprosy went away. Some people will take out of that River Jordan, out of the water, they'll take it back home, they'll drink, they bath with it, they'll be using it like lotion, they'll be using it like medicine. That's idolatry. Other people, like Jesus, took the clay and then he put in the eyes of that Indian and said, go to the post side and go and wash. Other people will then take that clay, that's what they'll be worshiping. They'll say, because of what happened, then take sand out of that area where that thing happened, take sand near the church, take sand near the building, and then that's what I want to kneel on that when I'm praying. I want to, you know, be seen that when I pray. That is idol worship. The worship means, look at the children of Israel, look at something that happened to them in 2 Kings. I'm reading from chapter 18. 2 Kings chapter 18. You'll see what we're referring to as worshiping the means of miracle, worshiping the means of healing. 2 Kings chapter 18, I'm reading from verse 4. He, referring to this great king, Hezekiah, he removed the high places and break the images and cut down the groves and break in pieces the brazen serpent that Moses had made. For unto those days the children of Israel did burn incense to it, and he called it Mehushtan. You remember that when they were in the wilderness, many, many years before. You see, thousands of years have gone. If you remember the time of the wilderness, before they even got to the land of Canaan, before Moses died, they were going and then they murmured because they were discouraged and serpents were biting them. And then they came to confess, we're sorry for what we have done. And then God said, raise up a brazen serpent, a serpent of brass, hang it upon a pole. Whosoever is bitten by the serpent, when he looks upon it, he will live. And then that miracle happened. All the people that looked on it, all those miracles happened to them. What then happened? They took that image, they took that brazen serpent, and they carried it with them to the land of Canaan at the time of Joshua. They carried it with them until the time of the judges. They carried it with them until the time of the kings. They carried it with them until David's time, Saul's time, Solomon's time, Jeroboam's time, and all of them until this time of Hezekiah. It was at this time now that Hezekiah said, look at these people, idol worshippers. You are supposed to be Israelites. You are supposed to fear the name of the Lord, worship the name of the Lord. But it was that sin they were still sacrificing the burning incense to. That's why it says that he took that brazen serpent, and then which Moses had made, for unto that time, until that time, the children of Israel did still did burn incense unto it, and they called it Mehushtan. All that was destroyed. They were worshipping the means. Other people worship mortal men. Mortal men. Maybe those mortal men, they do something that unheard of. It's something unbelievable. A great thing has happened. Apart from ministers, we're coming to Daniel chapter 2. Daniel chapter 2. I'm reading here from verse 46. Daniel chapter 2, verse 46. The Lord is telling us that we should not behave like those idol worshippers. You should not be traditional, you should not be a pagan, you should not be a heathen, you should not be a superstitious person. Whatever anybody does in the name of the Lord should point us to God. That's why it says there are signs and wonders. A sign is to point us not to the signboard, it's pointing us somewhere. A sign is like a signboard, and that signboard is pointing you to Christ. That sign and wonder that you wonder at, that amazes you, is not to stay with that signpost, is to be a sign that points you to the Messiah, points you to Jesus Christ, points you to the Lord, who will turn your life around, and the power of Jesus will work in us in Jesus' name. Look at Daniel chapter 2, verse 46. Then the king Nebuchadnezzar fell upon his face, and he worshipped God. Who did he worship? Worship Daniel, and commanded that they should offer an oblation and sweet odors unto him. You see that there are those who worship ministers, there are those who worship means, there are those who worship mortal men. Look at chapter 3 of that same Daniel. Nebuchadnezzar the king made an image of gold, whose height was 3 cubits, and the breadth thereof 6 cubits, and he set it up in the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon. Look at verse 6, that at what time ye hear the sound of the cornet and the flute, and the sound of the harp and sackbut and psaltery and dulcimer and all kinds of music, ye fall down and worship the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar the king has set up. And whoso falleth not down and worshipeth shall the same hour be cast into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. He worshipped Daniel in chapter 2, but he himself, he will see another worshiper. There are many people like that. You know, they will flatter the ministers of God. They almost be worshipping the ministers of God, you know, worshipping their pastors, worshipping whoever it is that they feel that they've seen a particular skill on, but it's just idol worship. I pray that we will not worship men. We will not worship any material thing. We will worship only God, the God of heaven. And that's what Paul the Apostle said. Come back to Acts chapter 14. That this God of heaven is a living God. He made the heaven and the earth and the sea and all the things that are therein. Let's stop for a moment. Here is Paul the Apostle. He's evangelizing these people actually. He's preaching the word unto them. But do you notice here, when he went into the synagogue, he will normally look at the Old Testament. He'll say, our fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, went to the land of Canaan and went this and here, and then eventually will come to David and then come to Jesus Christ, the son of David, who died and rose again. He will refer to the scriptures. But look at this now. These were pagans. These were idol worshippers. They didn't know anything about Genesis. They didn't know anything about Exodus. They didn't know the Old Testament. That's why he went to what they knew. You go from what they know to what they don't know. You go from the very far. Everybody knows that this world was created by the Almighty God. That's why he went to the God of creation and he said, this is what God does. And he has given us rain. They understood that they were farmers. He has given us the harvest. They understood that they were farmers. He has given us food. They understood that. And then he makes our hearts glad. We're happy when we eat the food, and when the rain is there and the heat is gone, we're happy. And then he introduced them to that same God. And that's what that's the wisdom we ought to have when we're preaching the gospel. If you're preaching the gospel, you'll not be quoting from, you know, Genesis to Revelation. The people don't know all that. You're in the boss and you're preaching according to Exodus chapter 12, verses 12 and 13, according to Leviticus 17, 11, according to Deuteronomy, and according to Psalm 2, verse 1, and according to Matthew chapter 1, verse 21. In a single message, you're preaching, and the people don't know anything about what you are saying. You make it simple, you make it direct, so that the people can hear the word of God and see that we are all sinners. We cannot save ourselves. Jesus died for us on the cross of Calvary. If we believe on him, he will save us. Make it very simple and direct, and the Lord will use your messages to save the people in Jesus' name. Acts chapter 17, I'm reading from verse 22. Acts 17, verse 22, then Paul stood in the midst of mass here and said, ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things ye are too superstitious. Paul the apostle met some other people too who were superstitious, who were idol worshippers, who were pagans. And he said, I perceive, I can understand. You are too superstitious. And as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with this inscription, to the unknown God. Whom therefore ye ignorantly worship, declare I unto you, God that made the world and all things therein. You see that? He didn't go to quote Old Testament and go to quote Songs of Solomon and quote Isaiah and quote Jeremiah and quote Daniel. He went back to creation, because that's what they understood. Everybody understands that God is creator that made the world and all things therein. Seeing that he is Lord of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hands, neither is worshipped with men's hands, as though he needed anything, seeing he giveth to all life and breath and all things, and has made of one blood all nations of men, for to dwell on all the face of the earth, and he has determined the times before appointed, and the bounds of their habitations, that they should seek the Lord. He's not going to talk about repentance eventually, but you know, he didn't make any quotation here. It's just telling them what they already knew, and he's going to apply that to them. I pray God will give you wisdom. When you present the gospel to your neighbors, you know their level, you know their understanding, and you know their background. And according to that level, according to that understanding, according to that background, you present the word of God unto them. If they're superstitious, you want to turn them away from superstition. If they're idolatrous, you want to turn them away from idolatry. If they're traditional people, you want to turn them away from the tradition of men that cannot save. It says in verse 27, that they should seek the Lord, if haply they might feel after him and find him, though he be not far from every one of us. For in him we live and move and have a being, as certain also of your own poets, of your own writers have said. You see, he quoted what they knew. He said, are you not reading your own writing? Are you not reading your own writers? For we are also his offspring. For as much then as we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the Godhead is like unto gold or silver or stone, graven by art and man's device now is coming to the conclusion, and the times of this ignorance God winked at, but now commanded all men everywhere to do what? To repent. Whether we're preaching to religious people or superstitious people, we must end with that. Whether we're preaching to those who know the Bible or those who don't know the Bible, if we're to lead them to salvation, we must end with that, that he has commanded all men everywhere to repent, because he has appointed a day in the which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he has ordained, whereof he has given assurance to all men, in that he raised him from the dead. He raised him from the dead. He's talking about Jesus Christ. It's only Jesus who says, and it's only Jesus who can redeem, who can bring forgiveness to them from their sins. That's why we talk about Jesus. And as we talk about Jesus, the Lord will walk in their hearts. They will believe in Jesus' name. We come now to Acts of the Apostles, chapter 14. Acts of the Apostles, we're looking at chapter 14. I'm reading from verses 19 and 20 now. And there came hither certain Jews from Antioch and Iconium, who persuaded the people, and having stoned Paul, drew him out of the city, supposing he had been dead. The people that wanted to worship Paul, the people that wanted to do sacrifice to Paul just now, the people that sang hosannas a few minutes ago, that sang their praises a few minutes ago, the people that got all the people together, rallied them together, let's worship these people. These are gods, these are idols. They have come to us from Jupiter. They have come to us from Mercury. Some people came to them and they poisoned their minds. You know, when somebody is not born again, you cannot rely on him. When somebody is not really saved, you cannot rely on such a person. They can come today and praise you and lift you up and exalt you and say that you are the only person they know. You are number one. You are, you know, there's nobody like you. In fact, we should be worshiping you and should be there. We serve everybody serving you because you're almost like a god now. You are a lord and all that. But some people will come and poison their minds since they don't have salvation. They don't have real righteousness. They don't have any conscience. They don't have any principle. And because there's no righteousness, there's no principle, there's no salvation, although they flatter you now, the next moment, you'll be surprised what they will do. And over here it says, they supposing he had been dead, they stoned him. They said, kill him. He's no more a god. He's just an ordinary man. And he's not even a good man. He's a bad man. How be it, in verse 20, as the disciples stood round about him, he rose up. Praise the Lord. I said, praise the Lord. Until you finish your work, nobody will kill you. Nobody will destroy you in Jesus' name. That's why your life must have a purpose. If you don't have any purpose you are living for, you can die anytime. If you don't have any goal, you say, this is the goal. This is what God has raised me up for, and I must do that thing, and you are faithful to that. Anything can happen to you anytime. But if you know the call of God upon your life, the commission of the Lord upon your life, and you're in the very center of the will of God, that this is what God has raised you up for, this is God, what God wants you to do, and this is why you exist. And morning, afternoon, evening, you are committed to that. Morning, afternoon, evening, you are consecrated in that. Morning, afternoon, evening, you are going on and moving on and doing just that alone. The Lord will protect you. And the Lord will preserve your life. But no, but the people that are just, you know, you are just in your room every time, you are sleeping, you are, you know, roaming about, you are not doing anything tangible for the kingdom of God. Anything the devil does, after all, when you were here, what were you doing? But if you are doing something for the Lord, you are doing something for the Lord will preserve your life. And now, as you hear that, what are you going to do for the Lord? Why do you exist? Are you preaching the gospel? Are you evangelizing? Or are you just coming to church and going out? You're only receiving, you are not giving. And we cannot lay hands on the fact that this is what you're doing. And you're doing it sincerely. And you're doing it faithfully. And you're doing it wholeheartedly. And you're doing it with all the skill and everything you have. And the Lord sees that you are faithful. Your mind is always there. Your thoughts are always there. there. Your commitment is always there. You spend your money, you spend your energy, you spend your time, you spend everything on it. The Lord will be watching over you because there are not many people like you in the world. And he has a work to do. He knows that he can entrust that work into your hand. When people want to come against you and want to hurt you, harm you, or destroy you, the Lord will say, no, this one, I need this one. I pray that you'll be precious in the sight of the Lord. It says in verse 20, how be it, as the disciples stood round about him, he rose up and came into the city, and the next day he departed with Barnabas to Derbe. That is that place where they stoned him. He came back there and he was still preaching the gospel. He said, whatever happens, I'm still alive, and I'm alive to do the will of God and to do the work of God. And he did it faithfully. That same faithfulness the Lord will give to every one of us. Do you learn something from all these people that, you know, they one time they wanted to worship, the next time now they wanted to, they actually stone him. Not only that, they wanted to stone him. It teaches us that unsaved people are, number one, unreliable. They praise you today, they're going to stone you tomorrow. They want to worship you today, and they're going to destroy you tomorrow. They talk fine, and they talk well in front of you, but you know, behind, they slander you, and they cut you down. They're unreliable. They'll shout Hosanna the previous week, and then the next week, they say, crucify him. Number two, they're unstable. They're unstable. You cannot depend on them. They are unstable. They praise you now, then they persecute you later. They are unpredictable. If you have anybody that, you know, is an unbeliever, is a sinner, and is hovering around you and is saying, you know, we love you, we appreciate you, we will serve you, we will do this, we'll do this, and then they are, you know, before you say good morning, they're already on the ground, and they're flat on the ground. Before you say good afternoon, they're already, their knees are already on the ground. They say they're very respectful, they are wonderful, except they are born again, except they are real children, except they are totally sincere and faithful and transparent. You cannot depend on that because they're unreliable, because they're unstable, because they're unpredictable. That's why the word of God is telling us, don't rest on sinners. Don't rest on sinners. Those sinners, you cannot rest on them. If you lean on them, if you are going to fall, you are going to break your neck and break your back and break everything around you. And then don't rely on the superstitious. Superstitious people, they see any little thing like this, because of their superstition, they are ready to sacrifice, they are ready to worship, they are ready to do this or that, but they are not born again. So you cannot rely on superstitious people. Don't rejoice with the sacrilegious. The sacrilegious are the people, the honor they ought to give to God, they want to give it to you. They are afraid of such people and run away from such people. They want to bring you into the judgment of God. You know, when a herald did something and said something, they said, that's not the voice of a man, that's the voice of a God. They accepted that. The honor, the glory, the exaltation they should give to the Almighty God, they gave it to Herod. He accepted that. An angel came and smote him, and he died immediately. I pray you'll not die prematurely. So don't rejoice in their sacrilege. Don't respond to the self-seekers. The self-seekers. You see, you have a little thing, maybe yes, you have some opportunities, and they think you can share that opportunity with them. You have some money, you can share that money with them. You have some contacts, you can share those contacts with them. Because of that, they are running after you, and they are singing your praise and shouting your praise. All that is just self-seeking. Do not rejoice in the sacrilegious, and do not respond to those self-seekers. Do not regard the strange singers. Those who sing and it's all your name, they know. They don't know any other person. You are the papa, you are the mama, you are the provider, you are the sustainer, you are everything, you are prophet, you are everything on earth. You are. It, that's strange singing. Don't respond to that. Don't regard them, and don't reckon with sycophants. Sycophants are the people, they are not sincere. They know what they are looking for. They want to suck you out. They want to siphon something out of you. They want to get something out of you. That's why they are doing what they are doing, saying what they are saying. Do not reckon with them. Don't replace the Savior with anything, with anybody. Hold on to that Savior. Hold on to the Lord. He is the Messiah. He is the Christ. He is the one that's a sin bearer. You want to hold on to him, never replacing the Savior. We've learned from these people how they wanted to worship and sacrifice unto Paul and Barnabas, but the next time they actually stoned him. I pray that God will deliver us from all such people in Jesus' name. But you see, Paul the Apostle, in spite of all that, he continued. He continued serving the Lord. You know, if you're a real child of God, you'll see many things. You'll hear of many things, and you'll experience many things. Opposers will be there. Persecutors will be there. The people that are insincere, they'll be there. Some of them will put you down. Some of them will lift you up. Some of them will knock you. Some of them will try to, praise you. Whatever they do, continue in the Lord. I said continue in the Lord. You'll continue in Jesus' name. And look at Acts chapter 26. I'm reading from verse 22. Acts chapter 26, verse 22. Having therefore obtained help of God, I continue. Having therefore obtained help from the Lord, they stoned him. He said, I continue. There was shipwreck. He said, I continue. And there were false brethren. He said, I continue. And there were slanderers. He said, I continue. There were persecutors. He said, I continue. I pray you'll continue. And he said, it's because I received help of the Lord. Having therefore obtained help of God, I continue unto this day, witnessing both small and great, saying none other things than those which the prophets and Moses did say should come, that Christ should suffer. That Christ should suffer, and that he should be the first, that he should rise from the dead, and should show light unto the people and to the Gentiles. The message is continue. I will continue. I will continue. I Romans chapter 11, I'm looking at verse 22. Romans 11, verse 22. Behold, therefore, the goodness and the severity of God. On them which fell, severity, but toward thee, goodness, if thou continue. Are you saved? If thou continue. Do you say you are sanctified? If thou continue. Has the Lord given you that heart that is transparent, that heart that is yielded to God? Has the Lord given you the heart that is washed whiter than snow, getting ready for heaven? Continue. If thou continue in his goodness, otherwise thou shalt be cut off. The people that do not continue in his goodness, do not continue in faith, do not continue depending upon the Lord, do not continue trusting the Lord, it says they shall be cut off. We're reading from 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3. I'm reading from verse 10. But thou hast fully known my doctrine and manner of life and purpose and faith and long-suffering and charity and patience. Persecutions, afflictions which came upon me at Antioch and Iconium and Lystra. Is referring to what came upon him in Acts of the Apostles chapter 4, chapter 14. He said, Timothy, you're from Lystra. Timothy was from Lystra. And he said, you know all the persecution, affliction that came upon me at Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra. What persecutions I endured, but out of them all, the Lord delivered me. He's referring to a time he was stoned and they left him for dead and the brethren came around him and then he got up and he revived. Your revival also. And it says, yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall, tell me, suffer persecution. And so when the persecutions come, don't be surprised. The pressure comes, don't be surprised. The slander comes, don't be surprised. The false brethren, they come, don't be surprised. The people that want to destroy you, and you hear news, you hear stories, so and so said such and such about you, so and so said such and such about you, and then you begin to cry and say, you see, I'm living my life, I'm saved, I'm sanctified, I'm serving the Lord, and they say this and say that. Have you forgotten the scriptures? Yea, all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. Look at verse 14. Tell me the two words there. Two words. The first two words. Tell me. Say it loud. But continue. I will continue. you know, whatever happens to people, whether the pressure is there, persecution there, pain there, all those slanders are there, all the problems are there. It says, but continue. You hear that, you know, you are doing your best or preaching the gospel, and then because of that, you know, the fire is burning, but continue. And the opposition and the fire of persecution is there, but continue. Continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. And that's the secret of really serving the Lord until the very end. I pray that you will not stop your journey midway, halfway, in Jesus' name. We come to Acts chapter 14 now. Confirmation of saved, steadfast members in the divine purpose. Confirmation of saved, steadfast members in the divine purpose. The Lord wants us to continue in that confirmed purpose, in that divine purpose. We're reading from Acts chapter 14. We're reading from verse 21. Verse 21, and when they had preached the gospel to that city and had taught many, they returned again to Lystra and to Iconium and unto Antioch. You see, that's the place they were, that Paul the apostle was stoned. That's at Lystra. He returned there again. Why? Because there were believers there. Because there were children of God there, and he needed to instruct them, establish them, he needed to encourage them, embolden them, empower them, so that they'll continue in the ways of the Lord. That's why courage is very important if you're a minister. That's why, you know, commitment is very important if you're a pastor. That's why devotion is very important, dedication very important if you're a leader of other people. Because if there is a, you know, problem there, they did that to me, they threw that at me in that other place, some people cannot bear a little problem. Nobody is even throwing stones at you today. They just throw some empty words at you, some empty slander at you, or some empty action at you to either mock you or mimic you or a kind of degrade you or disgrace you. And because of those little things that don't have any weight at all and don't have any pain in them at all, then you shy away and you say, I cannot go there again because, you know, they threw that at me. But I about Paul the apostle, that he went back there again, so that, look at verse 22, confirming the souls of the disciples and exhorting them to continue in the faith, and that we must through much tribulation enter into the kingdom of God. He encouraged them, he said, they must continue. That's why the Lord is reminding you again that you will continue. And then he says in verse 23, and when they had ordained them elders in every church. They ordained them elders in every church and had prayed with fasting. They commanded them to they commended them to the Lord on whom they had believed. And after they had passed through Pisidia, they came to Pamphylia. The important thing is that these ministers, they encouraged the converts, they encouraged the disciples that they must continue. This is what we call follow-up. We're looking at Acts chapter 11, verse 23. Acts 11, verse 23. Oh, when he came and had seen the grace of God, was glad and exhorted them that with purpose of heart they would cleave unto the Lord. He knew the kind of city they were living in, that Lystra, Iconium, and Antioch in Pisidia. He knew that kind of city. He knew that if they could do that to him, Paul the apostle, what would they do to all these new converts? He knew that those superstitious people and those idolatrous people, those pagan people, they will persecute these new converts. So they were encouraging them, cleave unto the Lord. And the same thing we're saying to those who have come to know the Lord. You have come to know the Lord as your personal Savior. Now you are born again. And the Spirit of God is bearing witness with you that you are a child of God. And the blood of Jesus Christ has washed you whiter than snow. And now you can say, once I was blind, now I can see. Once I was a sinner, I'm now a child of God. The righteousness of God is now inside me. The grace of God is working in me. Then you want to encourage such people, continue in the Lord, because persecution will come. We're told in verse 26 that, and when he had found him, that is Barnabas finding Paul, now finding Saul, he brought him unto Antioch. And it came to pass that a whole year they assembled themselves with the church and taught much people, touch much people, so they can be stable in the Lord, steadfast in the Lord, committed to the Lord. And so they courageously follow the Lord, whatever challenges they were receiving. Look at Acts chapter 13, verse 43. Acts chapter 14, verse 33. Now, when the congregation was broken up, many of the Jews and religious proselytes followed Paul and Barnabas, who speaking to them, persuaded them to continue in the grace of God. The grace that saves, continue in that. The grace that sustains, continue in that. The grace that has sanctified you, continue in that. The grace that makes you holy, righteous, pure, and godly, continue in that. In Acts chapter 18, verse 23. Acts chapter 18, verse 23. And after he had spent some time there, he departed and went over all the country. He went over all the country of Galatia and Phrygia in order, strengthening all the disciples. Can I remind the origin of Asia again? Can I remind you state of Asia again? Can I remind you national of Asia again? Can I remind you group, pastor, that it says that Paul the apostle went over all that country, all that community. And so that's what the Lord wants us to do. He doesn't want you to just sit down there in the local church, just doing maintenance ministry, talking to the same people year in and year out, and the members are not even evangelizing, and you cannot have a crusade there in that community and have a touch every local government there. It says he went into all the countries of Galatia and Phrygia in order, that is, all in an orderly fashion. He tabled every, there are 20 places there. I want to reach this one now. Next one, I reach that. And next time, I reach that. It says you develop strategies so that you reach them in order, strengthening all the disciples. We're looking at 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, we're reading from verse 10. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, reading from verse 10. Here Paul the apostle said, night and day, praying exceedingly that we might see your face and might perfect that which is lacking in your faith. That's why Paul the apostle went to the places where he had preached before. He wanted to see them again, visit them again, teach them again, establish them in the faith so that he will perfect whatever was lacking in their faith. Now, God himself, our Father, and our Lord Jesus Christ direct our way unto you. He wasn't waiting that, well, they will come to me. I have the message. I have the gospel. I have the standard. I have everything. If they want to grow, if they want to develop, let them come to me. He said, the Lord himself will direct our way unto you, and the Lord make you increase and abound in love one toward another and toward all men, even as we do toward you, to the end, for the purpose, so that he may establish your hearts unblameable in holiness before God, even our Father, and at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all his saints. We're looking at 2 Timothy chapter 1. 2 Timothy chapter 1, reading from verse 12. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 12. For the which cause I also suffered these things. Paul the apostle, he wasn't ashamed of his suffering, wasn't ashamed of his persecution, wasn't ashamed of those persecutions. You know, there are people that say, well, if I'm going to preach the gospel, I have this challenge. If I'm going to preach the gospel, I have this challenge. And, you know, people hate me, people slander me, and people do this and do that to me. And if I say I'm preaching to another person, now they'll say, okay, if that's your God is good, why has he not done this for you? Why has he not done this for you? Why are you suffering? So when God has removed all my problems, then I will do the work of God. It will take you a long time, because God is saying, be faithful unto me and be dedicated unto me and do what I want you to do. And if you will put me first in your life and put my work and put the ministry first in your life, then he will answer all your prayers. But if you're saying, no, I'm going to wait until God has done this, you'll wait for a long time. I pray you'll be up and doing in Jesus' name. For the which cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed, and I'm persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. Commit your soul to the Lord. He'll keep you until that day. Commit your spirit, your mind, everything you've got. Commit everything to your family. Commit your family to the Lord. You know, you've not got this, you've not got that. Commit all that to the Lord. He'll keep you until that day. Hold fast the form of sound words which thou hast heard of me, and faith and love which is in Christ Jesus. That good thing which was committed unto thee, keep by the Holy Ghost. That good thing which was committed unto thee, keep by the Holy Ghost which dwelleth in us. The gospel is committed unto your hand. Keep it. And the Lord himself is saying that this is what to do. He has called you to salvation. He has called you to sanctification. He has called you to separation from the world. He has called you to service. And as he calls you to service, that good thing he has committed to your hand, keep it. And you do it faithfully until the end. The Lord will be with you in Jesus' name. 2 Timothy chapter 4, I'm reading from verse 1. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1. I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom, preach the word. That's the gospel. Preach the word. Is committed that into your hand. The gospel into your hand. Message of salvation into your hand. The message of separation from the world into your hand. The message of holiness and sanctification committed in your hand. That's the word. Preach that word. Earnestly contending for the faith was delivered unto the saints. Preach the word. Be instant in season and out of season. When it's convenient, when it's not convenient, when it's easy, when it's tough. When things are going well and when things are not going so well, in season and out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long-suffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lusts shall they heed to themselves teachers having itching ears, and they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. But watch thou in all things, endure afflictions. Afflictions, persecution, slander, suffering, pressure, whatever, pain, endure affliction. Do the work of an evangelist. Make full proof of thy ministry. I will do it. I said I will do it. We'll do it in Jesus' name. Remember, we must not be hearers of the word only. We should be doers of the word as well. Let's rise up and talk to the Lord in prayer. That the Lord will help you, the Lord will help you, the Lord will help you, that you'll be committed to this work he has committed into us. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. That's what he has said. Don't just sit in one place, don't just stay in one place. Preach the gospel to every creature. Preach the gospel to every creature. And be doers of the word and not hearers only. If we're hearers only, just hearing and not doing, we deceive ourselves. Don't deceive yourself. Are you born again? Are you saved? Has your life totally changed? Is the Spirit of God bearing witness with your heart that you're a child of God? If you should die today, are you sure of heaven? If the trumpet should sound today, are you sure that you will see him in glory? Talk to the Lord. In your community, you are preaching the word, and then there's persecution, there's problem, pressure, pain, whatever. The word of God says, therefore, long time, therefore, they are bold, they are preaching the word boldly. Persecution did not stop Paul and Barnabas. Persecution did not stop Paul and Barnabas. Persecution did not stop Paul and Barnabas. Persecution will not stop you. Problems will not stop you. The pressure, the slander will not stop you. Tell the Lord, commit your life completely to the Lord.
Preach the word. Preach the word. Preach the gospel, the saving gospel, the sanctifying gospel, the gospel that turns us around, changes our lives, and don't allow those superstitious people to worship you. Don't allow superstitious people, pagan people, heathenic people, those praise singers to worship you. Sinners are unreliable. Sinners are undependable. Sinners are unpredictable. Aim at their being saved. Aim at their being repentant. Preach the word. They need to repent. Preach the word. And make sure that you yourself, that you are saved. That you are sanctified. That you are filled with the Holy Ghost, empowered for service. Continue. Are you saved? Continue. There will be persecution. Continue. Getting to heaven is a non-negotiable. Continue in the Lord. And those who are born again, follow up on them. So you can establish them in the truth. Establish them in the word of the Lord. Pray that God will give you the grace to remain saved, steadfast, separated from the world, sanctified, sustained in the grace of God.